get my shoes and out the door. 5, I'm alive. 6, 7, 8, feeling great. Hey, everybody. Welcome back to the Beyond Your Wildest Genes podcast. I am your co-host today, Dr. Mike Akinfora, and today I have with me Dr. Laura Kelly. Dr. Kelly, how are you?
Hi, I'm very good.
Wonderful. I'm going to read you Dr. Kelly's bio real quick, and we're going to get into the interview today. I'm very excited. Dr. Laura Kelly is a licensed traditional Chinese medicine practitioner and doctor of acupuncture and oriental medicine. She completed her medical training and doctorate at Yosan University in Los Angeles. Her private practice focuses on primary care and chronic disease. She's working with a research group to document the biochemical effects of Chinese herbs on fatigue and is leading the investigation on a non-surgical treatment for paralysis. On her blog, Case Notes at LauraKellyLAC.wordpress.com, she writes about her experiences in medical practice. In 2017, she will complete the Institute of Functional Medicine Certificate Program, that is IFMCP. She lives and works in Topanga, California. Dr. Kelly, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Michael. It's good to be here.
Awesome. So the first question that we ask folks when they come on the program is, tell our tribe, tell our audience about your journey. How did you get here?
When I was a very small child, I remember the teacher asking what I wanted to be, and I said neuroscientist, and I didn't know what that meant. But for some reason, that's what came out. That was when I was very small, and then that sort of passed, and I decided I wanted to be an artist, and I did that, and I went to art school, and I came out and worked as an artist for a long time. And then there was a little bug in the back of my head, and it was saying, there's something else for you to do, there's something else. And I didn't pay attention to it for a while, until it was so loud that I said, what are you? And it said, don't you remember you wanted to be a neuroscientist? And I said, oh yeah, that's right, I did. But I didn't know what that meant. And I still didn't really know what that meant because I didn't know which part of medicine I wanted to enter. So I started looking around. I thought about just traditional medical school because my brother's a surgeon. My uncle's a surgeon. And he's actually a neurosurgeon. So I thought, oh, I'll just go to medical school. That seems to be the right thing to do. And I started to look around at traditional Western medicine. And I felt that I wanted to approach medicine from a different perspective. I wanted to approach the perspective of keeping people well and exploring wellness rather than simply illness. So I looked around at different medical paradigms and came to Chinese medicine. It's a very well-documented medicine. Some of the books we use are 5,000, literally 5,000 years old. There are hundreds and hundreds and thousands of reports from doctors, from patients describing therapies and case reports and case reports and case reports. So for someone who's a researcher and sort of a more Western mind like I am, it provided enough information for me to say, I understand this and I can trust this and I believe this medicine, but also because it comes from a philosophy, and it's more of a philosophy of the connection of people to your environment and the environment to the world and everything sort of in a dynamic state of, of balance. And applying that concept to the body makes sense to me. So
I love it. So I am a storyteller, and I love telling stories. You've written a really unique book. It is not just a cookbook, but it talks about the name of the book is The Healthy Bones Nutrition Plan and Cookbook. Not just a cookbook, the whole first half goes through the dynamics of osteoporosis, and you've got some really neat information in there. But can you tell people the real life story about how this book came about?
Sure. Well, I was in school. My mother came to me and she said, listen, my doctor says that I must take an injection because my bones are so fragile. He's afraid I'm going to break them. So he said that he requires me to do that. And I don't want to do it. And I don't really know why, but I don't want to do it. So she said, is there anything else that I can do? And I said, well, I'm sure there is, but I don't know yet. So I said, give me a couple of months and let me try to wrap my head around the problem of thinning bones in this country and see what we're dealing with. In traditional Chinese medicine, there's, you know, quite a large percentage of it, and especially dealing with internal medicine issues, we use a lot of herbs. And one of the areas of Chinese medicine is trauma medicine. And part of the herbal structure of that is bone healing, because it developed out of the Shaolin monks when they were training. You know, there would be a lot of martial arts injuries, so they had to heal themselves. So trauma medicine deals with fractured bones very well. And I knew that. Mm-hmm. So I started there. And then I took a fracture map of the world and I looked at it and I said, why are there much higher fractures in certain areas of the world in terms of elderly fracture and much lower fractures in other parts of the world? And I started at that question and dug and explored and came up with a bunch of reasons, because there's never really only one, and put that list together and gave it to my mother. And I said, here are all the things that are affecting bone loss. And here are the things that you can do to strengthen and densify the bones. And she started with just a couple of those things. And on her next DEXA scan, for the first time in 20 years, she had no bone loss.
Wow.
So she did not even half of the things that were on that list. So that was the beginning of it. And, you know, her doctor said, oh, it's a fluke. And I said, okay, well, maybe, who knows. And then again, her 2-year DEXA scan after that, still no bone loss. So that was the beginning of it.
That's really cool. Dr. Kelly, osteoporosis is usually thought of as a women's disease. What is osteoporosis and who should be concerned about it? I know that's two questions. And how does osteopenia differ from osteoporosis?
Well, osteoporosis is measured by how less dense your bones are compared to the average sort of 30-year-old woman. Peak bone density in humans is around age 30, and peak bone density is important. I'm going to answer some other questions other than the ones you answered along the way.
Sure, absolutely.
Peak bone density is kind of an important thing to mention, because most people think, oh, okay, well, I'm going to wait until the system is set up so that when you're 65, you have a DEXA scan, or this is how it's been in the past, which is very late, because at that point, your bones already have become thin and have reached an osteoporotic state, which is a number of 2.5 standard deviations below what an average peak bone mass would be at 30. So peak bone mass at 30 is an important thing to mention, because it's really important. The stronger your bones are when you're 30, which is something that we should think about, the less likely you are to have enough significant loss later in life. So it's actually an issue, a lifelong issue, starting at around age 20, to start think about, am I strengthening my bones? Am I doing everything to get the most I can out of this so that I have room for bone loss that happens with later life? Generally speaking, women will lose some bone mass because of hormone loss. Hormones, estrogen, is very tightly tied into the cycle of bone generation and bone strength. So there is some bone loss that is going to happen. But it is not enough to put everybody into osteoporosis as we see here. If you start out with a very low bone density, bone mass in your peak years, mm-hmm. you're going to lose, it'll appear more drastic later on. And then you may end up in osteopenia, which is like a pre-osteoporotic state where you have some bone loss, but it's not enough to put you into danger. And osteoporosis is not in itself a problem. There is no real danger from it as a disease state. But the danger comes and the problems come with fracture, because the bone is now much less resilient. And fracture in the elderly, it can even lead to death, just because you're immobile and you're not functioning properly, and then you just sort of stop living, and then that's a morbid state. So even though in itself it's not a problem, it can have sort of dire consequences.
And that, yeah, we have heard stories of people have been leading what essentially they felt was a normal life, and they have a hip fracture, and that downward spiral, the older we get, has dire consequences.
Yep. So it's, you know, it's, and it also, again, as you're saying, it doesn't occur only in women. And this is another thing which really hasn't been very much discussed. I think as we're living longer now, in a cycle of living longer, it's coming up more frequently. And also the rise in osteoporosis is projected to be skyrocketing in Asia. And we know that it's one of the top five chronic preventable diseases in the U.S., with over 50% of people over 50 having some osteopenia and bone loss. And that is only over 50, so by the time you're getting to 70 or 80, the numbers are quite large. And that includes men. Men tend to lose bone density a little later than women. There's the larger frames, larger muscles will keep, the larger muscle structure will keep the bone a little longer. But when they're hitting 70, they're starting to show bone loss, and 30% of hip fractures actually do occur in men. And they actually are more prone to more difficulty after fracture than women are. So it's an issue as we're starting to live into 80s and even 90s. I don't know how far it will go, but this is going to become a major problem more so than it is. And it's a completely addressable problem. And that's health.gov, came out with their report from 2012 to 2020 in the state of health in America. And they very explicitly say that this is a preventable issue. So I wrote this book with my mother, for my mother and with my mother, to share that information and say, look, we can continue to, search for drugs, which partially work, sometimes, or we can say, let's just not get this problem in the first place. Let's just not have this problem because we can prevent it with, being careful about our diet and exercise and doing all the things that are good for us and not have to deal with it in the long run. So.
Absolutely. One of the things that you wrote that I think was so important, and I really need the audience to understand, is with what's called trabecular bone loss, it's 7 to 11% per decade. So at 30 is the peak, and most of us are living into our 70s and 80s now. You're talking 50% bone loss. That is astronomical. And what you're saying is it's completely preventable.
Right. I mean, I think that there's a much slower rate of bone loss while you're still in rich with hormones, while you're still, that larger loss comes after the hormonal decline. In general, if people are not doing the things in standard to keep up with with their bone mass. Again, it's if untreated, it can be really dire. And the other issue I think to bring up that's really important is that the way that this country looks at osteoporosis and measures osteoporosis is through a bone density scan. Mm-hmm. So what they're looking at is the mineral density of the bone. And one of the things that's left out, which I think is extremely important and really should be addressed if we're actually going to determine who is at risk, is the idea of flexibility. Because if we look at the Japanese, for example, everybody's osteoporotic because they're relatively small and their bones are relatively small and thin. But because of their diet, their traditional diets, I should say, that's changing, of course, but because of their traditional diets and sort of nutrient chemistry, which I have explored in the book a little bit, they have flexibility to their bones. So that's something that we don't measure. And it's also a whole nother side of taking care of the bone with collagen scaffold rather than just the idea of calcium, which is mineral and hard. So this is another piece of the puzzle to consider when you're considering taking care of your bones, is this flexible nature, because I would prefer actually to have a flexible small bone rather than a sort of dense brittle bone.
So the book is broken up into two sections, and it, like I said, it's so much more than a cookbook. In the first part of the book, you call it Take Charge of Your Bone Health. But what do you mean, and most importantly, is how can the readers take charge of their bone health, Dr. Kelly?
What I mean is that this is sort of a larger paradigm question of medicine. For quite a while now, it has been that the doctors would carry the weight of responsibility. And we would say, we know best, and here's the pill, go home and take it. And there weren't very many questions asked, and there wasn't really an involvement in the healthcare of that person. They sort of did what the doctor said. And I don't see that as useful in the long run. I mean, it's fine in certain circumstances, but when you're dealing with chronic issues that are lifestyle issues, it requires the participation of the patient, because the patient is really the one that's doing all the work. So I want to present the information. What I find in my practice and in general in life is that when you understand the reasons and you understand the function of something, you're much more likely to engage with it. And the patients who are curious about why they're doing things, do them,
yep.
Right?
Yep.
Instead of just me saying to them, do this, and sometimes they do it and sometimes they don't. They say, oh, well, this is really important. I understand the functionality and I'm going to be engaged in the process. And so I wanted to present the information so that people could say, okay, I understand how my bones work. I understand why they might not be up to where I'd like them to be. And I understand how to fix them. And I have the power to fix them, because of that's really important to me, is giving people not only the information. I wanted to give you actionable information so
sure.
that you can literally take charge of your bone health, and you can say, okay, this is something I'm doing for myself. I know exactly how to do it. I know why I'm doing it, and I can measure my progress and share that information with my doctor and my healthcare providers and have everybody involved in that process. And suddenly, to me, that feels like real healthcare.
Mm-hmm.
So.
I love that. I love that. You do talk about reclaiming the term natural food. So Pringles aren't natural, and ringdings and ho-hos. I mean, in New Jersey, we have a tree in the backyard with Pringles on them.
Oh, my God. That's a childhood dream. Wow.
So what do you mean by that?
Well, this was a discussion that I had with my mother and the publisher, and because I kept trying to come up with a term that would encompass what was real rather than what was synthesized or processed or anything like that. And we couldn't really come up with another term that was appropriate except for natural. And then they said, well, this is, no, you can't use that, because that's used by everybody and they lie about it, and nobody believes the term anymore. And I said, well, you know what? I don't care, actually, because the fact of the matter is that natural is, it retains its own meaning. And yes, people have abused that word, but I feel like I want to use the word properly as what it means, which is a natural state of a food, a natural state of health, a natural state of anything. And we know what those are inherently. We understand nature. We understand our place in nature. And for those people who have abused that word, I just wanted to reclaim it so I could use it, basically.
Awesome. And one of the things that I noticed, and I have always said that you can't supplement your way to good health if you have a horrible diet, but you really have some excellent thoughts on supplementation in addition to eating healthy. Can you talk about some of them with our audience today?
Sure. What exactly?
I was thinking, you know, because most people really think only calcium when it comes to bone health, and that's really it's just the tip of the iceberg. So if you just want to cover a couple of those, like vitamin D and K2,
well, sure.
stuff like that.
Well, When you're trying to build bone, of course, calcium is the major mineral that's in the bone. So of course it makes sense that we need to make sure we have enough calcium. But the way that the system works is a lot more complex than that. You can't absorb the calcium, most of the calcium in your gut, unless you have the presence of vitamin D at the same time. So they're right off the bat, just from when you're starting to ingest it, it needs a partner. It has a partner in vitamin D, and it must be present for a majority of the absorption of calcium. Your gut bugs have to be in good shape, and your intestines, there's the production of a molecule called calbindin, which also facilitates the calcium that's now starting to be absorbed to take it through the wall of the intestine. So as you can see right away, even just in the initial stages, there are all these pieces that have to be in partnership and working together for you to actually even just get the calcium into your system. So then you have, in order to get the calcium to deposit into the bone properly, one of the major pieces of that puzzle is a protein hormone called osteocalcin. Osteocalcin will not function properly unless it has vitamin D, magnesium, and vitamin K2. So without the presence of those three things, you're not going to get proper deposition of your calcium into your bone. So you can see that this cycle is, there's not one piece that is the key. They all must be present for that cycle to work properly. So a lot of these things are relatively easy to get in your diet in the West. We have a relatively high calcium diet. So more importantly are actually the nutrients that were not high in magnesium. A lot of the numbers coming out again out of the CDC, out of the government, are showing really massive deficiencies in the U.S., which seems very surprising, but in fact is the case. Magnesium is potentially looking at 60-70% of Americans having a deficiency in magnesium. Vitamin K2 is really a key vitamin in bone growth and bone health, and it's basically missing from the Western diet, which may be the reasons why we're having such severe osteoporosis in this country. So finding ways to include these nutrients in your diet is something that I am trying to help you do in the book, trying to understand, first of all, why they're important and how they work in the cycle of bone growth, but also where you can find them, what the sources are.
Sure.
And the other thing that's important is that even if you're taking, you can't just supplement yourself, as you were saying, Michael, you can't just do that because first of all, there's so many pieces and so many supplements that you'd have to take. But secondly, these things like the calbindins from the gut bugs, you can't take those. And you can't take you can take enzymes, but there are a lot of enzymes that are required for the breakdown and the translation of nutrients, because you don't eat a vitamin and the body just uses the vitamin in that form. The body has to transform that vitamin using gut bugs, using enzymes to transform that vitamin into a form which your body can actually use. So all of these things have to be working, and that's why within natural foods there are enzymes present, and there are inulin and things that are going to feed your gut bugs to produce the things that you need to help digest and get the nutrients from your food. So all of these things are not things that you're going to find in supplements.
Perfect. Before I get to the recipes in the second part of the book, again, a takeaway for the audience: in your recipes, you include some surprises, such as instruction on how to make your own butter, how to make bone health vinegar, and how to grow shiitake mushrooms. Could you talk about that a little bit? That's amazing.
Sure. Well, butter is delicious, and we need saturated fat. I mean, saturated fat was, you know, this is a big issue, as you know. It was the devil for a really long time. Fat is a complicated issue, but we do need saturated fat in our diet. I prefer raw milk myself for various reasons, and it was difficult to find raw butter, so we started making our own butter. and it's delicious. And it's got a lot of, you know, good bacteria in it and healthy fats in it. So that's one thing I thought we would share. The bone vinegar is actually my favorite thing in the book, because you can literally go into your backyard and collect what we would consider now weeds and put them into vinegar. And the vinegar draws the nutrients, including calcium and minerals, out of the weeds. Herbs are very high in general in calcium. These types, dill, these types of sage, these kinds of herbs are very high in calcium. So you can create a very delicious vinegar using very little money, right? You have a jar and you have a quart of vinegar, sorry, a gallon of vinegar, and stuff that you can collect in your backyard or buy, you know, online. And you have a wonderful, very rich, bone-strengthening concoction here. You have, maybe you'll have, depending on what you use, you're going to have 300 milligrams of calcium, which is, you know, a third of what you need, at least, if not more. So you're going to have phytoestrogens. You're going to have all sorts of minerals. You're going to have all sorts of nutrients. So it's a great thing to be able to make yourself.
My partners, Dr. Wanda Lee and Dr. Noah, they want to know how you grow your own shiitake mushrooms.
Well, it is in the book. You basically have a piece of wood and spores and some dirt, and that's what you do. And it just matters. It's just a question of keeping the sort of right temperature and the right sort of environment for the mushrooms, and they want to grow very much. So
I love that. So what are some of your favorite recipes in the book?
Well, apart from the bone vinegar again, which I just really have a thing for, I really like the poke bowl that I put together, because it's got a lot of options, and you can literally cover your entire bone nutrient intake if you ate a really big poke bowl for the day. And it's a great recipe in my mind to start with when you're looking at the book and starting to learn how to measure the ratio of the things that you're taking in and what you might be missing. Because with that particular recipe, you can say, you can look at all of the information. You say, this has this much magnesium and this has this much calcium. And you can literally build yourself a perfect bone health meal within that bowl. And I think that's a really great place to start, because one of the keys to the book is in each recipe has at the end of it how much magnesium or how much calcium, how many key bone health nutrients you're actually getting in this recipe. So I think it's a good way to start. Another recipe I really like is kind of a strange recipe, but it's incredibly delicious. And it's the watermelon gazpacho with basil oil. Again, it's very bone-friendly recipe. It's got a lot of ingredients. It's got a lot of herbs, a lot of spices, and it's a really delicious recipe. And again, kids really like it because it's got a little sweetness to it. And I also really like the butternut squash and natto recipe. Natto is the source of vitamin K2. And again, we don't have that in our diet in the West, generally speaking. So finding ways to get that vitamin into your diet is ideal. Supplementing is definitely something I recommend for that vitamin regardless,
sure,
because we're so deficient in it.
Yep.
But natto is not quite, it's not really, it's got a particular taste to it that's hard for Westerners to come to enjoy. The natto powder, the butternut squash natto powder soup, the natto powder itself, it eliminates that sort of strange flavor that natto has, and it actually is sort of caramelly. And so if you just puree your butternuts, your cooked butternut squash, and add some natto powder, you're getting maybe 400 micrograms of K2, and nobody knows exactly about the dosages of this vitamin yet, because the research is all relatively new. But it's looking at probably, on an average, maybe 90 micrograms a day. I think a bowl of natto generally eaten for breakfast in Japan contains somewhere around 450. So If you're going to have a nice tablespoon of natto powder in your butternut squash, you're probably getting another, I don't know, 200 or 300 micrograms, which is sufficient for a standard dose of K2.
That's cool. And here's the cascade is you need K2 to activate vitamin D. You need vitamin D for your magnesium. You need your magnesium for your muscles and your bones. They're all related and they play on each other. And you talked about in the book the ratios and the relationships that these minerals have and how important they are. And I think that's really important for our listeners to understand.
Yeah, one of the things that I came across when I started doing research was there was a lot of the two places in the world that have the highest rate of fracture for elderly are the U.S. and Norway and Sweden and Denmark, Scandinavia. Mm-hmm. And so I started doing when I started doing the research, I came across initially some reports that said vitamin A causes osteoporosis. And I started to look at that because I was like, well, I don't know about that. That doesn't seem right. And what had happened was that there was a lot of research done, I think, in the 80s in Scandinavia looking at how they had very high intakes of vitamin A and they had a lot of osteoporosis. And so the conclusion was that vitamin A caused osteoporosis. But what actually was happening was that because there is no sunshine there, mm-hmm. they have called a vitamin D winter, where there's virtually no sun. So they were having maybe a normal amount of vitamin A, maybe a high amount of vitamin A, but they were having 40 times less vitamin D than we're required to have as humans.
Wow.
So it wasn't the fact that there was too much vitamin A, it was the fact that there wasn't any vitamin D. So that really keys me into the idea that these nutrients, they're important in their own right, but they're also important in terms of ratios. It's really key to, you can't have one without the other.
Absolutely. And that is not, I would say, that's not common knowledge for the general public. So I think that's really important that you put that in there. And folks with getting their vitamin D and vitamin A levels to where they need to be to support bone health.
Right. And I mean, I believe that that's true across all minerals and all nutrients, mm-hmm. I think. It's not just vitamin A and D that need to be in ratio to each other. I think it's calcium and magnesium need to be in ratio to each other. Omegas, fats need to be in ratio to each other. So I think that across the board, all of our systems, everything in our body is in a dynamic balance, and that dynamic balance can be optimized for optimal health.
I love it. Laura, thanks so much for being with us today. Can you tell our audience where they can find you in the world?
Sure. Well, drlaurakelly.com has a bunch of information about me and a bunch of writing. The Healthy Bones book is the book website, so you can find out about the book. It's getting translated into German and Spanish at the moment.
Awesome.
So it will be released in Germany and Spain and Latin America, I believe, next spring. And I'm sort of putting together medicinethroughfood.com at the moment, where I'm sort of, as I write more books with, you know, covering more health issues, all, of course, with food and an understanding of nutrition, you'll be able to find the information there at medicinethroughfood.com.
I love it. Thanks again for being on the show. Folks, what I would appreciate is if you liked what you heard today, please go to iTunes and leave a review so we can help us help you. And I want to thank Dr. Laura again. All that information, the book, her website will all be in the show notes. And we'll see you next time. Ciao.
Thank you so much.